I'll share only a few of her many achievements with you. Dr. Tarter was the first person to hold the Bernard M. Oliver Chair for SETI Research and is now the Chair Emeritus for SETI Research and a member of the Board of Trustees at the SETI Institute. She served as the Director of the Center for SETI Research and as Project Scientist for NASA's SETI program, which was called the High Resolution Microwave Survey. She's a Fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, a Fellow of the California Academy of Sciences, where she was president from 2015 to 2016, and a Fellow of the Explorers Club. She was the Jansky Lecturer at the National Radio Astronomy Observatory in 2014, coined the term brown dwarf, and has an asteroid named for her. Time named her as one of the 100 most influential people in the world in 2004, and one of the 25 most influential people in space in 2012. She won the 2009 TED Prize, has received numerous other awards for her efforts to communicate the excitement of scientific discovery to the public, including two public service medals from NASA, and was the principal investigator for two projects aimed at improving science education for elementary and high school students. She's also a member of the board of directors for the Starmus Festival. We're very fortunate and privileged to have her here to speak to us tonight. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Jill Tarter.
So, it's...
Oh, wait a minute.
One more technicality.
Green, we're good. So it's I'm just delighted to be here tonight and to be able to talk to this phenomenal astronomy club. You mentioned Starmus. I'll give you a heads up that 2019 we'll be holding our sixth Starmus in Bern, Switzerland. So stars and music. Some of you might like it. I wish you'd come. In 2004, Craig Venter and Daniel Cohen wrote a paper in which they made a very bold claim. They claimed that whereas the 20th century had been the century of physics, the 21st century is going to be the century of biology. And they were talking about proteomics and genomics and all of this wonderful genetic engineering, and I think that that's playing out faster than they could have possibly imagined. But I don't think they were bold enough, because I think the 21st century is going to be the century of biology on Earth and beyond. So why do I think that we might find life beyond Earth, and how might we do it? Well, we could discover it. We could find within our solar system in situ biomarkers, maybe even artifacts in the solar system. We've seen that in science fiction. Or we could image and chemically assay remotely the atmospheres of these thousands of exoplanets that we now exist out there and look for disequilibrium chemistry that might indicate biology on the surface of the exoplanet. Or we could detect its work product, life's work product. That would be looking for technosignatures, evidence of some technology that's being used in some way to modify the environment that we can sense remotely. Or we can build some new piece of equipment and look at the sky in a different way, looking for something, and serendipitously detect evidence of life and technology. Or finally, we can explore it. We're talking about going back to the moon and to Mars, mining asteroids. We're even talking about interstellar voyages with Breakthrough Starshot, accelerating little packages that are about a gram in weight to the nearest solar system, or the 100-year starship study to see whether we can make humans an interstellar species, and things like the Icarus spacecraft study. So I think life beyond Earth is a good bet in this 21st century. And when you begin to think about that kind of thing, you really have to reorient your point of view, your perspective. You have to start talking about here and now in a different way, a much bigger point of view. And so let's think about it. What do we mean by here and now? Well, clearly we're here, right? In the Empirical Theater, which is here inside the Oregon Museum of Science and Industry, which is here in Portland, and we're now getting familiar with this kind of perspective from Google Earth. But if you were at the altitude of low Earth orbiting satellites, you'd see us here in the northwestern part of the United States. And since 1968, when Bill Anders took this image coming around the limb of the moon and gave us this Earthrise picture, we've begun to see ourselves here. So this is really the first shot that we've had at a cosmic perspective, understanding our place. And then back in the summer of 2013, Cassini, which was in orbit around Saturn, turned around and took a selfie. Took a picture of all of us. There's a little white dot beyond the end of that arrow, and that's us. Everything, everyone, that's us. So I hope you got the memo and went outside and waved to Cassini when it took this selfie. But that's not the first time we've seen a picture of ourselves from afar. In 1990, when the Voyager 1 spacecraft passed by Neptune on its way out of the solar system, it turned around and took this image of a pale blue dot. And we got to see ourselves in a different light. We're here, right, on the outskirts of a beautiful spiral galaxy. And no, nobody went outside the galaxy and took that picture. This is the galaxy that we think looks very much like the Milky Way would if you could go outside the Milky Way and take a picture. And we're not anywhere near the center. We're out in the boondocks. We're not in any special place. And indeed, our sun is only one of about 400 billion stars in the Milky Way galaxy. And that galaxy is one of something like 200 billion galaxies within the observable universe. So that's what we mean by here. And when you look at this beautiful image from the Hubble Space Telescope, you see that some of those galaxies are fainter and smaller because they are farther away. And then that makes us remember that as we look farther out in space, we're looking farther back in time. And thus, we have to rethink what we mean by now. So from this perspective, now is the current epoch of the universe's 13.8 billion year continuing evolution from the Big Bang to Big Brains and beyond. I have to confess that today, even scientists are not completely comfortable with this larger context of here and now. Because in fact, we directly observe only about 4% of the mass energy density in the universe. The rest of it, we call dark matter, dark energy. Dark just means we don't have a clue. We don't know what this stuff is, but we're saying it's there. Or we don't understand gravity. That could be another explanation. And in fact, cosmologists really struggle with this because at the smallest scales and the earliest times, it's still not possible to reconcile quantum mechanics and gravity. They just don't play well together. And so we have to say that at the moment, this is the most self-consistent picture that we can put together about here and now. But we expect that it will change in the future as we learn more. And I have to stress that humans are intimately connected with the universe on this scale, with far away places and long ago times. So you see, we humans trace our lineage not just back through the centuries of our families, not just back through the millennia of human civilization with its art and its architecture and its many experiments with governments, We trace our heritage not just back over the millions of years since we branched off from the apes, not just back over the 2.4, that's just ET calling, not just back over the 2.4 billion years during which the Earth's atmosphere has been perfused with oxygen thanks to the photosynthetic labors of cyanobacteria, not just back to the formation of the sun in our solar system 4.6 billion years ago, but back beyond that, another 4 or 5 million years, to the giant molecular cloud that was contaminated by the winds of Wolf-Rayet stars and the debris of supernovae explosions. The iron atoms in the hemoglobin molecules of your blood, the calcium in your bones, and everything heavier than helium that makes you you was cooked up, fused deep within massive stars that ended their lives in catastrophic convulsions, leaving behind remnants like this beautiful recent example. Remnants that became incorporated into our early solar system, and just as this modern supernova remnant will be incorporated into the future generations of stars and planets and perhaps life. So it's taken us millennia, literally. It's taken us humans that long to piece together this story. And today, we still continue on our journey to try and understand more. We're driven by curiosity about who we are, why we are, what else might be out there, and of course, who else there might be. So over my career, there have been two incredible game changers that have altered the course of our journey, and those are extremophiles and exoplanets. So extremophiles are life as we did not know it until just a few decades ago, thriving in places that we once thought completely hostile to life. And they are now illuminating the amazing possibilities for life on our